This is my story of how, as a young filmmaker, I became caught up in a nightmare that would rob years of my life. With my video camera, I was trying to protect some of the world's oldest forests. But I threatened the interests of a billion-dollar logging corporation. That company, Guns Limited, was determined to shut down free speech. It sued me and 19 others for millions of dollars. We became known as the Guns 20. I was at risk of losing everything. It's only now that I can go back to Tasmania to try and make sense of how I became Defendant 5. This is me, Heidi. My parents were teachers who loved travelling. So every school holidays, they'd pack us kids up to go on their shoestring adventures. We camped around Australia and backpacked throughout Asia. Travel opened my eyes to inequality. As a teenager, I picked up a video camera, and making films became my passion. I went to Tasmania when I was 23 to make a film about the island's ancient forests that were threatened by logging.
Have you seen trees this big?
Absolutely.
Well, I would consider these the last of the giants of the northeast.
And you come here and you still hold out some hope. But when you go to this in the early stages of logging with the machinery there, that's the really heartbreaking thing of it.
That's the loggers' future that they're carting away. Their sons, their grandsons' jobs, they're carting them down the road every day.
These were some of the oldest trees on Earth, and it broke my heart to see them being logged and turned into wood chips to be shipped to Japan to make paper. I documented the effects the logging was having on the community.
If the wind blows, it blows all the sawdust directly into Burnie, and all the residents in Burnie have been complaining for years and years and years about not only breathing the dust in, but how ill they've been.
I wanted to use my camera to help protect the forests. I never imagined my films would get me and others into serious trouble. There was one company profiting most from the destruction of the forests. Guns, the biggest woodchip company in the Southern Hemisphere.
Guns was 80% of the entire native forest sector in Tasmania, trashing 5 million tonnes, primarily of old growth forest. Every log truck on the road, every bit of polluted water course, every scalped hill, every 1080 poison disaster, it all came back to Guns.
For 3 years, I filmed the campaign to save Tasmania's forests. The protesters were taking more risks, and by filming them, so was I.
Stopping the Hampshire woodchip mill, which is the largest woodchip mill in the Southern Hemisphere.
G'day, sir. How are you going this morning?
All right, don't touch any of that gear.
By trespassing, I'm requesting you to leave the site.
Protesters locked themselves onto machinery to shut Guns down. As the campaign escalated, I crossed a line from filmmaker to activist.
You are now required to leave. The gentleman will escort you. Okay.
Can I just get your name and number, please, yes, for our legal records?
Sergeant Tustian, 568.
My footage was broadcast on the news. My little video camera defied this giant corporation, exposing the truth and showing how far people were willing to go to stand up for what they believed in. The Wilderness Society, a leading Australian environmental organisation, hired me to make films for them.
So much of our campaigning had become very kind of fact-based. We desperately needed something that would portray the emotion of the campaign, and the material that you introduced in the form of that beautiful little film suddenly actually made the emotion very present.
Once the forests were cleared, poison was used to kill native wildlife.
The impact of those was quite profound. You go into a meeting anywhere in the world, and I use them all over the world, and after 7 minutes, they'd be shocked and saying, wow, this is a big problem. What do I have to do to help?
Support for Tasmania's forests spread across Australia and around the world. But not everyone agreed. The fight to protect the forest deeply divided Tasmania. Forestry workers, many of whom worked for Gunns, believed their futures were at stake.
The timber industry is the most sustainable industry of any in this country.
And just carry on with your own thinking.
And carry on with your
bullying. Stop being such a bully.
I'll get a job and leave ours alone.
The conflict over logging was a major political issue. And looking back now, I naively underestimated Gunns' reaction. Just before Christmas, a strange man in black appeared at my office with a shocking delivery. Myself and 19 others were being sued by Gunns for $6.5 million. They claimed we were in a conspiracy to destroy their company.
Its lawyers are Melbourne-based too.
I don't know where they are.
We became known as the Gunns 20.
I will now ask to come before us the Gunns 20, as they are named in the Gunns writ. Alexander Marr, Beth Defendant, Heidi Douglas.
I'll never forget that day because my life was changing and I had no control over it anymore. And that feeling of stepping up there in front of the community and suddenly I was a player in this massive chess game, you know, between an almighty powerful corporation and really a bunch of community members who'd been standing up for their backyards. The Gunns 20 defendants were a disparate group. Campaigners, elected politicians, students, doctors, a writer, and a dentist. We all cared about the forests, but Gunns claimed we were working together to deliberately undermine their business.
The way Gunns had framed their case, there was a charge that there was this overall campaign against Gunns and that everybody had conspired to harm their business. And the conspiracy consisted largely of the campaign to protect Tasmania's forests, so that anybody who was involved in that campaign was potentially a co-conspirator. They'd come together to form this plan, which we might have said was about saving the forest, but in the pleadings it became this plan to injure Gunn's business. And that was a very scary precedent for free speech, because it criminalised the practice of democracy.
If they could get away with this, they would build a new body of case law in Australia which would allow similar companies to go after any civil society action that got in their way.
Why do you think I personally was sued?
The case was fundamentally about silencing dissent and trying to weaken the campaign. What was one of the most powerful new campaign tools that needed to disappear? Yeah, they were your films.
Only 4 days after we were sued, it became clear why Gunns was out to silence us. The company announced plans to build a giant pulp mill in the Tamar Valley. This would double Gunns' wood chip production. Gunns claimed this was an industrial zone.
It doesn't look very industrial.
No, it doesn't look very industrial. And that's why we feel so insulted with all this. You just have to come here and see how beautiful it is to know that.
The mill was fiercely opposed by people who feared it would pollute the region beyond repair.
This was a billion-dollar-plus company. His share price had gone up every year for the previous 4 years, so they just thought it was going to keep going up, and all they had to do was stomp on a few people, build the biggest pulp mill in Tasmania, and then lock the entire Tasmanian economy into making them rich.
Before I was sued, I'd been planning to buy my first home. My lawyers advised me that if I lost this court case, Gunns could take everything I owned. But I refused to give up my dreams and went ahead and bought the flat anyway. It wasn't the joyful experience I imagined it would be.
My house.
My refuge was under siege. The threat became very real once the case began in the Supreme Court.
The whole thing was about building a conspiracy theory, and they needed as many connections between as many of the defendants as possible.
The conspiracy claim was ridiculous, especially as many of us had never even met before. But now, our fate was bound together.
The potential for 20 defendants to turn on each other in that environment was just huge. That was one of the big fears at the beginning. You know, you dump 20 people in a room and say you're all liable for what everyone else has done. But, you know, everybody had their own individual struggles with the case.
I realised that I was a link that connected us. I'd filmed everyone in this room, and in doing so, had put us all at risk.
It was a clear issue for where you sat in the case that you were one of the links between the Wilderness Society and a number of the other defendants, where you'd been and filmed actions that weren't Wilderness Society actions, and some of it was before you were working for the Wilderness Society or when you're only part-time and you're going out filming things, because that's what you did.
And your name?
I don't think I have to give you my name, do I?
That's what I said to you twice. You don't have to give you a name.
That's fine.
All that was going to be where they were going to get the evidence for this conspiracy from, which has much broader ramifications for filmmakers and journalists generally, because it puts them front and centre in terms of people likely to be sued, because then you can drag all the documents and the information that they've gathered into court.
I had no idea that the footage that I had been gathering was actually going to be used as evidence.
I was mortified that the things I'd been doing to try and help the community were now going to harm them. And my very right to film and to continue my work as a filmmaker was under question.
I remember you calling me and asking me to stop filming any independently organised protests. So why did you do that then?
At the time, I asked you to stop filming independent actions because this was... We were clearly under surveillance. You in particular were clearly under surveillance. The only way they could have even started making the allegations was to have people under surveillance.
I didn't know if I was just being paranoid, but sometimes I could see strange men following me and taking photos of me, especially if I was with other defendants in public places. And I was scared. This was where I was living at the time, alone. And then one day I found this camp directly across from my house where it was obvious that somebody had been spending a lot of time watching me. And I didn't feel safe to live in my own home anymore.
I filmed the only thing I was allowed to, me.
I just feel so disempowered now. And I don't really know why. I just think that having somebody tell you that you're so wrong. And sometimes I just want to die. I remember calling you when I was having a breakdown. You were the person I spoke to. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do. I do remember it quite well. And what you experienced, and you were the first to experience it, that level of fearfulness, within 2 years was being widely experienced throughout the organisation and throughout all of the litigants as well.
7 months after we received the writ from Guns, the judge threw it out of court, saying the claims were vague and didn't make a clear case for a conspiracy.
I've been fighting a fair bit of depression about this case, and I don't really want to put all my eggs in this basket and think, oh, yeah, this is the end, because I just can see this continuing on. Guns is probably already working on another writ.
Sure enough, Guns did come back to court, armed with a new writ, three times the size of the first one.
Is this the stuff they referred to right at the end?
I knew it was another work of fiction, but that wasn't the point. Guns was winning by tying us up in court.
In the courts, Guns had the firepower, the money, the silks, and they've put aside millions to fight this case of shareholders' money, not theirs. But the individuals who are fighting to protect the forest are personally exposed, while the board of Guns and its CEO sits in splendid, isolated protection, knowing that even if they lose the case, it's not going to cost them a penny. That's wrong.
Shagged out after a hard day in the court.
So how did it make you feel generally by the end of the day, though?
Oh, just cranky. Such a waste of money and time. Everybody sitting there and thousands and thousands of dollars tied up in that courtroom. Yes. I don't care about winning. I can't win. I can, however, bankrupt us.
I was angry and frustrated and powerless to fight back. But the attack on us brought out many new supporters. One of them was Paul, a committed activist leading the pulp mill campaign.
Don't look at me.
Hello, honey.
Paul taught me to smile again. And we fell in love.
statement?
Version 3 of the statement of claim has been chucked out.
Yay!
The judge just went for the fact that they were basically claiming too much against too many people.
We kind of expected it to be thrown out because it's so ridiculously huge, this allegation against all of the 20 of us, so... And what is it now? It's been almost 2 years.
Well, they've got to do something different in order to resubmit it, because the judge has made it plain, according to Greg, that if they put in the same crap again, they're going to cop it big time.
I was trying to get on with my life, but there was no stopping Guns. Every time the company was thrown out of court, it came back again and again. Guns wasn't giving up on its pulp mill plans either. While we continued to fight Guns in court, the Tasmanian government bypassed planning procedures and fast-tracked the mill.
We couldn't sit by and let the opportunities presented for Tasmania by the pulp mill slip through our fingers.
Guns had staked everything on the mill and needed to borrow over $2 billion to build it. My boyfriend Paul led a campaign targeting banks and other investors to make them aware of what Guns were up to. After months of lobbying and protest, the strategy worked. The ANZ Bank withdrew their support for the pulp mill, quickly followed by the other big three Australian banks. This was a major setback for Guns. Throughout the long years of the court case and the controversy, the forests continued to fall. Though the court case still loomed over me, I decided to follow my heart.
Yeah, good mate. Thanks for hanging out down there.
Yeah, it's not a problem.
Good luck with it.
Thank you.
But I was tying my new husband into this legal nightmare. And together, we risked losing everything. Back in court, the judge ordered mediation to see if we could avoid a lengthy trial. We met with Gunn's lawyers.
The last month we've been going through mediation and I've just had some really exciting news that I'm finally out of the case. Yes! I have now regained my freedom of speech.
After 4 years of proceedings costing millions of dollars, Guns had failed to substantiate its claims and agreed to drop its case against me and the Wilderness Society. But other defendants still faced going to trial. However, I was finally free to fight for the forests again. There was one European bank still considering financing Guns Mill. I made a new film that revealed what was really going on.
We had heard that there was one Scandinavian bank who
was considering seriously investing in the project. And so we organised a meeting and I said, look, before we start talking, I just need to let you see what you're joining your brand to.
The film showed a napalm-like substance being dropped from helicopters to burn away what remained after logging. Within days of my film being released on the internet, thousands of the bank's customers threatened to close their accounts. The bank joined a long list of investors who refused to fund the mill.
They had this company doing two things that appalled them. One was, you know, destroying these beautiful forests, and the other was suing people for standing up and trying to defend them.
With its share price in freefall, Gunns desperately needed to reform its reputation. The trial for the remaining four defendants was just weeks away. On the very eve of the trial, after 5 years of legal warfare, Gunns conceded defeat.
Gunns have totally capitulated and that we've just had a resounding victory.
All the remaining Gunns 20 defendants were now free.
You're supposed to drink the whole bottle.
We had always hoped that Gunns would be part of the solution. Certainly the purpose of the campaign was never to destroy Gunns, it was to protect the forests.
After dropping the case against us and under new management, Gunns announced it would stop logging native forests. But it was too late. Abandoned by investors and the public, the company collapsed.
What history shows is if the shareholders listened to us earlier, they'd be $1.5 billion better off than they are today.
I know I paid a really high price by getting involved in this story. I'd like to think that I would do it all again and be brave enough to be a witness and a filmmaker to an issue that was dividing the community. Because I now know that we all had a responsibility to bring truth to light. But in the end, it was Gunns who paid the ultimate price. And their investors and shareholders and workers all lost out because Gunns didn't listen to the community.